Thank you for coming to our debate. We've got some pretty good candidates. This is a way that you can at least hear them talk, answer a few questions. The questions that we will be asking were all submitted by our central committee. So we had 26 people. A few of them wrote down questions for us that we could submit. The way we're going to do this is we'll draw which office starts, and then if someone can loan me a quarter because I forgot my dollar that I flipped last time, I'll flip a coin.
Can we trust you?
This is where you're really playing out of the pressure.
Everybody throw money at
him. I got one shot. Whoa.
Even better.
Yeah, but this is a sack of Jawea.
He's got two tails.
Anyway, then we'll flip a coin to see who goes first. The idea is I'll ask a question. Each candidate will get 2 minutes to respond, and then they get 45 seconds as a rebuttal to their opponent's response. So it's 2 minutes, 2 minutes, 45 seconds, 45 seconds, and then each one of them will get 5 minutes after the end of the three questions to do a summary of why you should vote for them. So that's kind of how it's going to go. You'll see all those candidates. There's a few other people around that you know you should also talk to. One of them's over here, Dave Kintz, who is your county coroner. He's also up for re-election, but nobody in the county wants his job. Actually, he's done such a terrific job for Park County and getting Park County up to where it needs to be that I think anybody's afraid to run against him because they wouldn't stand a chance. We also have Michelle Miller. She's not here tonight. She's up for re-election, as well as our county assessor or county surveyor, Jack Kirby. Probably nobody in here has seen Jack Kirby because he's out and does his thing occasionally. A lot of the people in the central committee go, "Who are you?" But again, he does a great job for the county and has no competition there. If you're a Republican, this is an important election. If you're a Democrat, please cover your ears. We have got a lot that we've got to recover in the state of Colorado. We've got, Jim Wilson is up for re-election. He's our HD 60. Our district is so good that the Democrats couldn't field an opponent for him. So we have our state representative running unopposed. We also have Kevin Grantham, who's our SDG, our Senate district. He's up for re-election. And once again, our district is so good that they don't have anybody running against him. So both of our state representatives have no opponent, which means we in Park County have a pretty easy job once we get past our primary. I mean, we got a couple of people. We've got a Democrat running against whoever our commissioner candidate is, but that usually doesn't go over too well. But what we've got is the ability for Park County to help some of the others. When I was over in Hartsel last week, I said, we've got Senate District 5, which is Chafee and Gunnison and that part. It's an open seat. We can take it back. The numbers are in favor. We have to fight Pitkin County, where they have a lot of money, but we can take that one back with some help. So I'm trying to get people to help there. On this side of the county, we've got Jeannie Nicholson next door, who we all know and love and refused to answer any questions at one of her town halls because she was afraid of the questions that might be asked. She was one of the ones that led the fight to take away the magazines and do all of the things that they did with guns. She is also vulnerable. She only won by 300 votes last time. So we look at it that we've got Tim Neville running against her. He's a great candidate. He was a former senator. They redrew the lines. So we kind of lost it because of the way they redrew the lines. But we've now got a great shot to take that Senate district. So what I would like you to think of is, as we get into August, we need help. And it's not just we need money. Of course, we always need money. You always need money if you're in politics. But we need help. We need people that would be willing to make calls, maybe work the Evergreen area, and do this type of thing for our candidates so we can start taking back things. We need one seat. We need one net pickup in the state Senate to take back the state senate. If we take back the state senate, we can stop a lot of nonsense. We need 5 seats in the state house, and we can take back the state house. Little tougher because the Democrats drew the lines, but with this election coming up, I think we've got a shot at that. And then we've got 4 guys running for governor. Hopefully we will get the best one as far as can he win, and we'll take back the governorship. If we can get those 3 things, then we can reverse everything. If we get 1 of the 3, we can stop them from doing any more. We've got to start thinking that this election is the first one, 2014. 2016, we need to solidify any gains we've got, take a few more. 2018, we've got to make sure we hold it, because in 2020, that group that's elected has to be Republicans, because you draw the lines for all the districts out of that group. We didn't pay attention last time. We hit 2010, had a Democrat for governor, both houses were Democrats. And we have got some horrendous things that they did. Anybody that lives in Shawnee should know that you got this really neat line. This side is CD2, that side is CD5, except for this one little sliver that goes across the highway to pick up a few people because they didn't quite have the right number. They did the same thing in Berlin. They drew lines that made no sense just so they could draw the line to try to make our great congressman from this side safe. I mean, it was kind of safe anyway because, you know, you got Boulder in there. But we have got an opportunity this time. We've got a really good candidate in George Ling. I think we can really make some inroads. And if we can work hard for a couple of our statewide candidates and some of our local, we might be able to just kind of push things along to make it a little easier so we can get back control of the state. Anyway, that's all I have to say. And you're all thankful, I know. Assessor. Angie, Dave, would you like to come up here?
Come on down.
Ready?
Tails.
It's tails. That's 5 in a row.
Ladies first. All right.
Okay, you ready? Okay, how important is it to have a good working relationship with the county clerk's office? Give an example.
Well, the county clerk's office, actually it's important to have a good relationship with every office. The smoother that we all work together, the better it is not only for the taxpayers, but also for us. And the county clerk's office does the recording, and it's very important that we have all of the documents as accurate as possible. They have to record whatever anybody brings in. So we get this all the time because it will come to us and we may reject it because something's not right, and the people will go yell at the poor people working in the clerk and recorder's office, and it's not their fault because they have to record everything. They don't have a choice. So they're not lawyers. They're not meant to give you advice. They have to record, no matter what you put down. So it's very important that we work together, because if they kind of will ask us and we can't give legal advice, then we can kind of push them along, okay, this is what you need to look at previously. So it's very important to work together.
Okay. Angela is absolutely correct. By law, all of the documents that we receive and obtain to deal with things like changes in title or death or marriage or whatever the document says, by law must be recorded at the county clerk's office and become a matter of public record. So just recently, I forget exactly how long ago, Debbie can maybe mention this, but we went to something called iCounting, which allows the sharing of her recording electronically. We have given them permission in both planning, treasurer, and clerk to have access lookup only to our administrative system so that we can utilize each other's talents. We can look at the recording electronically without having to walk over to the clerk's office, which has been really, really good. We've integrated with the planning department years ago to do what's called APEX, fancy word. It simply gives us an electronic diagram of the improvement or the buildings. So I encourage you, I'm going to do a little plug here. Tomorrow night, if you want to learn more about the property tax system in general, come to Property Tax 201 in this building at 7 p.m. And I guarantee we will be out of here before noon. 2 hours is more than enough time to deal with property tax.
And so Dave is right in that we've been working more and more. We also have been calling each other a lot more to work together because all of us integrate together. So we need to work together. And that just helps every person that comes in here. And sometimes we are going to send you to the other offices because we don't know the answers. But at least we're working together.
Yeah, we had a gentleman in the office today who needed to talk to Michelle about a tax lien. It was in the wonderful place of Pikes and Isabel Village. One lot, which is 60 foot by 120. So those of you who know anything about Pikes and Isabel Village know what a wonderful, fabulous place it really is. But we were able to send him to the treasurer's office because they had more dialogue than we did. But I've got a basic premise. Small county like Park, we don't have a lot of money, we don't have a lot of resources, but you will always receive service. That's what we are here for. The only thing we exist for is to provide data and service to the folks.
Dave, do you support the tax abatement process? Why or why not?
It's a matter of law. Abatement, for all of you tax-interested people, is basically when we use it as a device to clear up an irregular or an illegal assessment. For example, if someone goes in and makes application to the Division of Property Tax Exemption Department, we don't deal with who is exempted from taxation. We are only told that, now here you go, here's what the deal is. Abatements have been in law for forever, about 4 years ago, as I recall. In that part of the formal process, the assessor shall be present or his representative to present evidence. It's in front of the county commissioners in a regular hearing setting. There's a record kept, and the people have the right to petition above the commissioners to either district court binding arbitration or the Board of Assessment Appeals. Which is the most common. But abatements were now raised from a matter of process in amount of tax dollars to more than $10,000. We don't have to go through the formal process with the commissioners. I will tell you, probably 30 years ago, we worked with the treasurer and commissioners at the time to be able to do quick fixes for folks rather than going through all the brain damage of that bureaucracy process, to where we had the authority by resolution to do up to $1,000. What this change did was, quite frankly, open it up so there's less bureaucracy brain going on. We can deal with obvious problems, get people on their way, and solve it.
And the abatement process is one of those processes, yes, we have to, it's the law, we have to enforce. It's like your right to appeal, it's your right to go to county board, it's your right to go to state. It is your right, and you can do it every year, and we're not going to take that away, and neither is the state. So it is a process that we have to do.
Yeah, we don't have any choice. It's been in law for a long time. So you have the right to appeal every year, whether we change your value or not. You have the right to appeal if you don't like the way my shirts are always nice and dull. You have the right to appeal just because the sun rose in the east. I mean, you have the right to appeal every year, and that is never taken away from you. I can tell you, and happily to tell you, that our count as of today is 202 appeals for the entire year. So we had a very light year last year, and the only people we changed, the only people that got a postcard, were when we actually changed your value. Otherwise, we work with the treasurer's office and put that nice little slip in, and that saves us about $26,000 a year to do that every even number year.
return. What should the daily duties of the assessor include?
My idea of the daily duties of the assessor include being part of the team. We've been cut again and again, and that's just part of downsizing. Everyone in America is used to downsizing now, and everyone has taken on more duties, and your role in what you have done changes. And so my idea is you are part of everyday working, getting your daily tasks done, meeting all your deadlines, and doing everything you need to do in Park County. That's just my idea of how it should be.
My approach has been pretty consistent all the way through. You know, a month and a half after my 24th birthday, three county commissioners in Park County gave me the opportunity to serve as the assessor. Now, you have to understand a little bit, and this is going to date me, but I'm going to do it anyhow. From 1966, when my old friend Fred Horn, of which Horn Cemetery is named in that family, ran for commissioner. He was the assessor, and he ran for commissioner. So until 1980, between 1966 and 1980, in that 14-year period, the average time of the assessor in Park County was 16 months. 16 months. It took me 4 years when I first got into office to figure out where all the problems were, because if it was a problem, they just pigeonholed me. And it took literally my first 4 years to get a handle on what the office is. I am not a micromanager. I have had enough leadership training through the Rocky Mountain program, University of Colorado Denver, and all the other courses I've taken to have to rely on people. I am responsible. I am responsible 24/7. Everything that goes on there is responsible to me. But I have learned that I have to delegate to folks, and I have to entrust those people to do their job. And we're there. Every cog in the team has their purpose. And unfortunately, sometimes the employees of that don't see the things we do outside of those walls. A lot of my job has nothing to do with inside the walls of the assessor's office. Policy matters, legislative matters, dealing with other assessors or other entities. Those are all encompassing into that. Responsible for everything, but have it no other way.
And that might be. It's just my management style is different. And it's not that I'm a micromanager, but I just know that sometimes the workload gets to be too much, and sometimes you have to change. And that's just how I approach it, and that's how I'm looking at it.
I don't have a lot more to say. You know, I've tried to be consistent. I've tried to be conservative. I've tried to bring common sense. I've taken pride in the fact that in my 35th year with Park County will be June 18. I've tried to always take pride in trying to be as small a bureaucracy within a bureaucratic world as we can be. And so I think that's recognized through the Flume Awards, the best public office to do business with. That includes everyone. That's just not one person, but that is a testament to the people there. I come from a real, you know, a real world job, family clothing store. Service is what we're about. That's all we offer, and we're very proud of being able to do that.
Okay. That concludes the questions. Angie, I think you get to go first with your 5-minute summary.
Okay. I'm going. All right. So, since my last debate, I sat and wondered to myself, why am I doing this? This is not my comfort zone at all. And I decided what it was is I do have a passion for my job. I have a passion for my job. I have a passion for this county. And I love living here. And I love my job. I got an opportunity in 2005 when I moved here. I started in the front office. I have moved on and progressed in my career there. I went from doing personal property, which is everyone's favorite thing. I came from a state that did not have personal property. Didn't have a clue what I was saying. Oh, yes, I'll do it. Quickly learned I was hated by all. But that's okay, because it gave me a good background in dealing with the people, dealing with the system, and enforcing something that's not popular. from that, then I got a chance to be an appraiser. I went on and got my certified BRES. And doing that has also given me the opportunity to go to state and present cases at the appeal level. And all of this has expanded the knowledge that I've had in that office. And so it comes down to is I just have a different vision of how I want things. And that's probably why I'm putting myself through this, is I just have a different way of doing things. And we have gotten less and less help, and I don't see that changing. We're not a county with a lot of money, and I don't think we're going to get employees back. And so I think things just have to be rearranged. The workforce and everyday things have to be changed. Even our goals along the way have to be changed. And I decided to put myself out there to see if I'm passionate about something. I don't sit and complain. I do something. And I am out here doing it. So that is why I went ahead and ran for assessor. I appreciate all of you coming tonight, and I'd be honored to serve as your assessor in Park County. Thank you.
You know, I'm very fond of Angela. I can't figure out why this is going on. You know, I've been trying to do that, but to me, really what we're talking about is inside baseball of the Republican Party. That's really what it appears to me, and I know they're shaking their head no, yeah. But when I asked Angela why she was running, she told me, and I quote, "Well, the party said if I wouldn't run this time, they would never support me in the future." And when I asked Mr. Chairman, he says, "Oh, we had nothing to do with that." So I don't know who's a fibbing and who's not, okay? All I know, folks, is my record is very, very clear. It is 34 years long. You will never see that again. Now, I grew up around a courthouse. You know, one time my aunt was the librarian. My aunt, other aunt worked for the clerk. My cousin, Leapin' Floyd, was the sheriff. I just love calling him Leapin' Floyd. There's no particular reason for that. My dad ended up being the caretaker of the courthouse, and my dad retired as the maintenance man at the county courthouse after working 34 years in the selective service system. My dad signed my draft card, for those of you who can remember that. And that was not a popular job, but I knew that he did his job with ethics and with honor. I had my Uncle Keith, was a non-attorney judge. And every time he came up for retention, he came in right after 1966 when Justice of the Peace went away, until 1992 when he was forced to retire at the age of 70. Every time he was up for retention, his percentage of yes votes went up. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm old school. Maybe I'm square. Maybe I'm, you know, not hip for today, but I can tell you I was trained by the people that I very much appreciate. My hometown assessor was one of my mentors. You have to understand this. He served for 44 consecutive years in Kiowa County. I used to be able to love to say that he'd been in office longer than I'd been alive, which was true. But from Jimmy, I saw as a kid growing up, the people at the courthouse were people of honor. They were people we respected. They were our community leaders. As elected officials, we are leaders, whether you like it or not. We are leaders of our community, and my community involvement I have been so proud of, because serving on the Upper South Platte Water Conservancy District for the last 29 years, we've been able to take this basin and make it whole for future and expanded growth and development for the next 50 to 100 years. We've been able to do that with a lot of hard work of a lot of people. It certainly wasn't me. With the Headwater Authority of the South Platte that we created in 2007, they managed that blanket plan for us. We can actually provide you water for expanded uses or non-compliant uses and not have to go back to court. My legacy is set, ladies and gentlemen. I'm proud of my accomplishments. I'm willing to give you one more term if you will give me the honor and the privilege of serving you one more term. And I ask you for that. Experience counts.
Thank you. The Park County Republican Party has in our bylaws that we are not allowed to support any candidate as a central committee prior to the primary. That's in our bylaws. I would challenge you, we've got some precinct committee people around here. Talk to them. Our central committee never, at any point, went to Angela and said, you have to run, because we cannot do that as a Republican Party. We pride ourselves on being open. We've got a couple of candidates who I had never met, who wanted to run for the other offices. You'll meet them tonight. I feel we have treated all of them fairly and openly. If they have questions, they ask them, we help them. At no time have we given any preferential treatment. Okay. Sheriff. You ready?
Go ahead.
You're going to
call it my call.
Oh, what do you want?
Oh, it's heads.
It is. The first one in two nights. Cases involving the Animal Control Division in the last few years. What changes, if any, were made or would be made because, or would you make because of these cases? And what is your opinion on allowing animal control officers to carry weapons?
Well, that's a good question. First of all, thank you for coming. I always enjoy these get-togethers. You know, we've gone from animal control, now we call it code enforcement. Some of the cases we've had over the years, the big one, we had the Vern Wegener case, we've had buffalo, we've had horses, you name it, we've had it. And I got to be honest with you, with everything we've done, probably wouldn't change a thing. We've got great people, they do a great job. That's been very cost effective. I don't have to have certified peace officers in there. I've got individuals that put in many, many long hours, sacrifice a lot of their time to go to trainings. They've been certified animal protection agents. They just do a wonderful job. So they've been trained well. They do carry a weapon. They've had good firearms training, so I can't think of changing a thing. I just appreciate all their hard work and very supportive of that program. Thank you.
Only 2 minutes?
2 minutes.
Okay.
Well, then you get 45 seconds.
Okay, good. Okay. Animal Control Division was a very important division for Park County. It still needs to be. In 2011, Sheriff Wegener decided to make them code enforcement officers to go into the marijuana grow operations to check for complaints on plants. That was the reason why Sheriff Wegener wanted them armed. I provided the firearms training for the animal control officers. There was three of them at the time. I did a 40-hour class. I talked to the sheriff about why we need to arm these animal control officers. Yes, they do have a need to defend themselves, but also, why are we sending a civilian person into a marijuana clubhouse when we have a certified deputy, specifically probably our investigations division, already? One minute. And when you take and dress a civilian in a Park County deputy uniform, dark blue uniform, wearing a gun, not certified, not post-certified, that puts a lot of liability on the county. It puts a lot of liability on those officers themselves. When you see this animal control officer walking down the street in trying to do the performance of their job, you don't know if that's a post-certified deputy or not. And when those officers are in a convenience store, they need to get fuel and stuff, what's their authority to act on something when they're armed? And the only training they've had was 40 hours of my firearms training or firearms training that we provided to them.
You know, I think we have good policies as far as how they act. Now, do I, you know, under the state law, I have the ability to deputize those individuals to perform tasks. They do not have to be post-certified. Kind of the advantage of knowing the law. You get individuals that can perform a task just like they do in the jail, just like they do in Denver, just like they do all over the state. They're not all post-certified. We do this as cost savings. Now, would I sure love to have a whole bunch of post-certified peace officers? Ideally, would love to. Would you like to pay more taxes? No. Where's that money come from? We just can't get it out of the air. So that's why we do it. They've been very effective. Thank you.
Okay. We're not Denver. We're Park County. We have a statute. It's Title 16, 2.5. It starts about 103. What the description of a sheriff is, a deputy sheriff, a jailer, a peace officer, a state patrolman. Yeah, you can deputize them for an episode. You can make them wear a weapon or deputize them for an episode. But day in, day out, the liability is huge for this county that those ladies present.
Okay, thank you. Next question. Mike, you get this one first.
All right.
How would you handle and defuse a situation where a federal agency wants to take action in our county that should be handled by our sheriff's department?
Depends on which agency. Obviously, the sheriff is the chief law enforcement officer for the county. I would try to find out why or how this federal agency is here. It's a very broad question, and I need more specifics on that. Obviously, there may be some authority with the feds. Obviously, we want to work with our federal agencies. And if it's something that needs to be dealt with on a local level, then I think the sheriff needs to address that. And if we need to call Washington, we'll call Washington.
We've had that situation, actually. We had a federal agency that came into the county. They have a risk assessment that they did. So they came down to Guffey, and they had these six guys all dressed up in SWAT gear. They surrounded the house and made entry up to the door and handed the individual a piece of paper. I said, you have got to be kidding me. I said, why did they do that? Well, it's because your rule. There was no cell phone coverage. The individual had made a threat that he doesn't want to, he wants us to go to court and he won't cooperate. And gosh, he was just a very mean guy, and they had a whole bunch of other criteria. And I said, well, if you'd have given it to one of my code enforcement officers, she could have dropped it off on her way home. Look at everything that you did. Had that guy been armed, which he normally is on his property, what would have happened? It's because they don't know Park County. I know my citizens. I know what their needs are. They come to me when there's a problem. Very, very proud of that. I talked to him, told him, and I said, even though you're with the IRS, I said, let me know next time. We could have taken care of that in 5 minutes. This is the kind of thing for me that's really, really important, because as you see, so many times we've got so many different agencies that come in that think they know about Colorado. They think they know about what small rural counties have. We have good people. People love coming out here, but they also are very protective of their rights. And I think as a sheriff, you have to know those individuals. You have to be willing to stand up for them. That's what you're supposed to do. So, thank you.
I wouldn't send a code enforcement officer to an address where the feds were dressed up in SWAT gear, specifically knowing that that resident probably is armed. I think I would probably send a uniformed deputy down there instead of a code enforcement animal control officer.
Again, that's the difference between a sheriff and a deputy. Sheriff knows the citizens. Deputy needs to come to the sheriff and ask the sheriff what to do. I know this individual. This individual is so upset about it, he came to my office. We sat down and talked about it. I complained to the U.S. Marshal, John Camerzell, and said, yo, when you have your next SAC meeting with all the rest of the supervisory agents, I said, why don't you see if they can't kind of come to the sheriff. I said, let's talk about this. I said, we're kind of overkill. You know, you can't run just because there's a gun. Lots of guns. It's Colorado. We deal with them every day. That's what training does. Thank you.
Okay. Fred, how do you or will you provide training to keep our deputies up to date? How is training to be funded?
Well, that's, you know what, we do a lot of training. Thank God we have Central Mountain Training Foundation. You all so graciously, through your license plates and those fees, that goes into a fund. Those are distributed throughout the state. Those funds were meant for rural Colorado, so that counties like mine can find training, affordable training, at sometimes little or no cost to the agency. The training that we get out of there has just been superb. I've got one of my captains is also on the board down there. Monty was the past president of the board. I think we have a lot of in-house training that we're able to get through instructors on arrest control and firearms. Let's see, the taser and toxalizer. So we try and do as much in-house training as we can. You know, just realizing that a lot of the bigger training facilities in Denver and whatnot, it's going to take additional funds because you're going to have to probably put folks up per diem and stuff like that. So we try and do as much in-house as we can, but, you know, thank God for the Central Mountain Training Foundation, we're able to go through that. So that really does help us out. Thank you.
The Central Mountain Training does provide quite a bit of training for us, and it is free training. It would be foolish not to take advantage of that. Prior to the foundation being set up, we trained in-house. We used our own instructors, so we didn't have to travel. We sent one person to travel, one hotel room maybe a couple. Sometimes we shared rooms if it was the same gender, and we saved money that way. I want to continue to use certified instructors in-house, obviously for arrest control. When I was there, it lacked, and we weren't up to standards every year. We skipped a lot of training when those periods needed to be met. The firearms program was good. We've gone away from training as much as the sheriff's office needs to. The firearms program has, since I left, even just before I left, we're using non-certified instructors. And that's a liability for those officers. And specifically, when you teach firearms off of an internet printout, that's not the way to do it. I'm a certified instructor in both handgun, shotgun, patrol rifle. Qualifications were not being met up to standards, not even up to post standards. And I'll change that. And I'll make sure that we're up to date on training and making sure that we're abiding by statute. Training's important. And not only with the firearms, arrest control, I've gone to one driving course that wasn't even a certified driving course. And we've never recertified our deputies in driving. we need to send deputies to a lot more training. Domestic violence and interview techniques. Only got 2 minutes. Don't stop.
wrong. we do have a state-certified instructor. teaching firearms. Sven Bodilek also teaches down at the college. He did receive a state certification, so it is state certified training. We also, a lot of the training that we do get, we try and send folks. If you can't send folks to a school where you get somebody to go down and become an instructor, bring that training back, that's always encouraged. Still takes money. You know, you just can't just all of a sudden, I'd love to do training. You'd love to do training every day if you could. It still comes down to your budget. If you don't have the money in your budget to do it, it's not going to happen. So we work very hard on trying to provide good training for the folks. And it's continued to be great. Thanks.
Okay. Sven Bonalik is certified in handgun only. He is not a certified instructor in long gun who has been teaching our long guns and certifications. I am a NRA certified instructor. I teach at Colorado Mountain College. I am a post lead instructor. I teach instructors to teach.
Okay. You want to go with your 5 minutes?
Sure.
That's great.
You know, let me say that it's been an honor. You know, this is my coming down to my end of my fourth term. It's my 42nd year living in the county. You know, it's my 27th year in law enforcement. You know, my certifications, my training, my experience is unequaled in this election. Nobody can match that. Mike was a good deputy. Mike quit. When faced with adversity, he quit the sheriff's office. That, to me, speaks volume. Because when you're faced with adversity, you rise above it. I have met those challenges. Colorado's largest wildland fire started in Park County in 2002. Since that time, we've had other ones that have grown bigger. We've also had the High Meadow fire. We've had numerous homicides. We've had, 14 homicides in the county since I became sheriff. We've risen up to those challenges every single time. I'm very proud of the fact that right now we have the lowest crime rate in the state of Colorado in Park County. Just don't let that out. My folks, day in and day out, provide a great service. Can Mike Brown become a sheriff? Yeah, I'm sure he can. And eventually, he probably will, if that's what he wants to do. There's one word Mike doesn't have in his vocabulary. That's compassion. And it's also passionate. I'm very passionate about being sheriff. Never take it for granted, not one single day. To me, it's an honor to stand up to represent the citizens of this county as I stood beside 53 other sheriffs and sued the state of Colorado. What did Mike do for the Second Amendment? You know, I have, my wife and I have lived here. We've raised our kids here. My grandkids are here tonight. And I'm not going anywhere else. This is the county I love. Wouldn't have stayed here this long. I mean, the people that we've had, the relationships that we've built over time have been just fantastic. Department of Corrections. I have a wonderful relationship with the Department of Corrections. Mike talks about contacts. He talks about building a rapport. Well, I talked to the warden down at Buena Vista. He says, never heard of Mike Brown. I said, well, he tells everybody that he's building a rapport and building a contacts down there. He said, you know what? As it happened. I said, well, that's funny, because that's what he's telling everybody. He said, well, I'll take care of that. I have a relationship with the Department of Corrections that's outstanding. Never have lost a contract. Have had one to this day. Mike tried to say we lost a contract. No, we lost inmates. That's because they took away the boot camp program years ago. Love to get those back. We worked very hard on that jail. And I'm proud of the men and women that work there. I appreciate your support in the past. I hope I can earn it again and keep your trust, because that's what it is. It's public trust. And I know that my folks have all earned your trust. Thank you.
Folks, it's time for a change. The change is the way the sheriff's office conducts itself. Fred Wegener just excused me for not fighting through adversity. Yeah. I took a very, very, very tough call. Something that Fred Wegener doesn't believe in due process. And we'll take a person and we'll demote you, take money away from you, and then send the case to the DA's office. And the DA's office says, Mike was right. Mike did the right thing. Mike stood up and fought. Mike stayed on. I served you. I served you for 16 years. The last 2 years, I have so much encouragement. You got to change the sheriff's office. It is definitely time for a change. So when Sheriff Wegener really treats his people, I wouldn't want to treat anybody like the way I was treated. And it's not just about me, it's about serving the public. And I believe in due process. I don't believe in convicting someone before you have all the facts. And even then, it took 13 months to talk to Fred Wegener. Is that how we treat employees? No. I will work with the deputies. I will encourage them. I will make them into better deputies. I will raise professionalism tenfold than what it is right now. And folks, I've been in Park County for 16 years. And I've enjoyed working here 16 years and working up through the ranks and serving everyone like I would serve my family, treating everyone like family, making sure the deputies I supervised were doing the right thing. And the warden in Buena Vista, he just took over. He's very busy. Warden Langridge is a very good warden. We have a lot of employees. I work a swing shift, and I don't get to see the warden. I will continue to make contacts with the ECA standards, with the safety folks that come up and did inspections on the jail. You never lost a contract. You're holding parole violators, yes. You're not holding DOC holds. You lost a female contract over a case, the Tracy Cairns case from a couple years ago. And folks, we're going to continue to work on this jail, and we're going to continue to try to get these contracts and fill that jail. The boot camp program, not coming back. Boot camp is used for training in DOC now. So I'm going to continue to work with DOC and those folks there. And the warden is a new warden. He's trying to figure out his job. And when I have the opportunity to walk into the warden's office and sit down and say, hey, I'm Mike Brown, I'll be more than happy to tell him how it is up here. I will be fiscally responsible. I will reduce the chance of these 10th federal court cases that are going on right now. My understanding is they just got a summary judgment on a Walker case, a dog case that was generated by our animal control division. We have another case in federal court right now, spawned right here in Bailey. That one's going to continue to go on. It costs the county thousands of dollars in research, in time, and with the county attorney working to get that. I will work to reduce the chance of another federal court case being filed. We also have another 10th federal case, and that's a discrimination case, and that case is going on. So working through adversity and stuff, yeah. I've had it tough. And people ask me why I kept going. Because I care. Because it needs to be done. And I am passionate about the people I serve. And all the shootings I've been in Park County here, all the major stuff, I'm here for you. I'll make sure we're up to standards. Thank you.
Okay, thank you guys. Thanks. County Clerk.
I have something.
It is heads.
You can go first.
Okay.
I went first last week.
How are the new election laws impacting our county clerk's office?
Actually, the new election laws make the county clerk's office real easy. I'm not a big believer in the new election laws because I'm old school. I think election day should be the first Tuesday in November. You go in and you vote, you get the little badge that says I voted. All the votes are done in one day. How they're done now with the mail-in ballots leads a lot of controversy into the, are all the ballots counted? There was a little controversy, I believe, 4 years ago. I believe it was all finalized, and they said that the ballots were okay. But that's the problem that you have with the ballots. The Democrats have the thing, vote early, vote often. This is how you do it, by ballots. Again, you can lose a ballot. There's ways to count ballots when you get them. Every day, seal them, have two people count them, put them in a box or an envelope, seal them, put them away. Don't count them until election day. Election day should be election day. There should be no precursor to this at any time so that somebody says, boy, if we only had this many ballots, this initiative could pass, this person could be elected. That's what I think about the new election laws. Okay. Debbie.
I support the new election laws. Colorado has become an all-mail ballot state. We have proven that by the work that we do as elected officials, the county clerks, and our election staff. We, in Park County, were over 70% mail ballots. State of Colorado was over 80%. That is where we went. We got a bill passed to become an all-mail ballot state. We still have early voting. We can come into the Fair Player and Bailey office, surrender your mail ballot, and vote early. You can vote on election day. We have tightened our security of in elections. We are under camera. We are logged. We document everything. Everything is sealed. From where we were in elections 18 years ago to where we are today has done a 360. We are very proud of the way we run our elections, because what we have done as a county clerk in elections, Colorado is number 4 in the United States of America for how we handle our elections, the security, and my judges, I've had them work A to Z. We've had Secretary of State's office up and had them work with us to see our processes and procedures. We have gotten kudos from the Secretary of State's office. It's because of my staff, the county clerks of Colorado, that have put Colorado where we are. If we didn't have faith in mail ballots, we wouldn't have gone that way. But that's where the faith of the county clerks in elections have gone.
I'm not sure the percentage of county clerks in the state that are Republicans or Democrats, but the way this thing was passed, it seems to me like there are more Democrats than county clerks than Republicans. I'm prior service. I was Air Force, I was Army, and when I was gone, I got to vote because I wasn't here. I believe that the only people that should be allowed to vote by mail are servicemen serving away from town or their home. I guess I'm good.
Debbie?
Well, party doesn't matter to the county clerks if you're a Democrat or Republican. We work together. I couldn't tell you if there was more Democrats or more Republicans in our Clerks Association. It doesn't matter. It's called working together, team. This is where we went. This is where the trend was going when we were permanent mail-in voters, PMIBs. It just picked up. It's helped the people who are away, our snowbirds that we call them, that move away in the November time. You know, we mail them a ballot. You know, emergencies come up. You know, so get your mail, you know, we send you a mail ballot, you mail it, and you're done with it. Bring it into us if you don't trust the post office. And I think the security that we have instilled in our elections is there.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Okay, Debbie, you start with this one. Why do you want to be our county clerk? What do you bring to that office?
Why do I want to be your county clerk? Well, 18 years ago today, is when I walked in the office and Ms. Pascoe hired me, the previous county clerk. In their 18 years, she got a blank sheet of paper. I had no idea. I knew I got my license plates there, and I knew that's where I filed my deed. And she had faith in me. Within 5 years, I was appointed. She had worked me in every department, and her comment was, damn it, Debbie, you're gonna learn it. And unbeknown to me, 2 weeks she was gone, I was handed a budget. I did the budget. I've done 14 of them now, and I am proud. I am passionate about my job. I've worked all areas. I have an awesome staff. We've been voted the best Park County offices in the Clerk and Recorder as runner-up. I'm a team player with my staff. I have staff that's been there anywhere from 17 and a half years. That would be Jody in your Bailey office. Barb has been there 5 and a half years. We work together. I am here to serve you. I am running because I want to continue to serve you. I'm not looking for a job. I just want to complete what I'm doing here. And there's lots of technology coming down in the next couple of years in all aspects of the office, and I want to be there to help that happen. Thank you.
Kim. I've been outside looking at this office for a long time, and there needs to be some changes. Too many times I've heard people complain about how they were treated in the clerk's office. I come from a whole different background than that. My management skills have been worked on the years since I was started my own company and back in 1984. I was in the service, like I mentioned earlier. I worked on the president's plane. You don't get to do that if you're a schmuck. I worked on it several times. I went to CSU for 6 years. I'm going to bring a lot of management skills that aren't there right now. Fairness to employees. I want to make it a better place for people to come in. We serve the people in this county in that office. I'm looking forward to changing some of the attitudes that we've got in there and making it a place where you can come and enjoy coming in there instead of feeling like you've been put into a cloud.
My staff has a good attitude. We meet once a month. We talk about issues in the office, what we can do better. Customer service is number one. And that's what we've always given. And every one of my employees is cross-trained throughout the office. That's how I became appointed. And I feel like with my experience and education has put me here. You've had faith in me to re-elect me the last 3 terms. And I think I've proven myself with my staff and what we have done. The Bailey office, you were just a motor to the office. And when I came in, what can I do better for Bailey? You were my first priority. Mail ballots. Drop off.
I'm glad to see that everybody's getting cross-trained. That was one of my first things that I mentioned when I said I was going to run for this job. I believe in cross-training every individual in there so that if we miss somebody that's key, somebody else can step in and get the job done. I don't believe that happened until, I think Debbie said last month, that they finally were cross-training everybody. I think that's a wonderful thing, and if nothing else ever comes out of this, at least that whole office will be cross-trained, and I'm glad I got to start that.
Okay. You get to go first on this one.
That's great.
What ideas do you propose to evaluate as cost-saving mechanisms for your department if elected?
Well, one of the things I'm going to do to save costs is I'm going to watch my turnover rate. It costs so much when you lose people, and there is a big turnover rate in that office. Every time you have somebody go out, you have to spend other time and monies training these new people. Basically, this office that I see is it's a stepping stone to get into other jobs within the county. Women will come in there and get hired. They learn for a short time, and then as soon as there's an opening somewhere else, they apply for that opening. That's a huge cost savings. The $100,000 that you asked for the new voting machines, I called the Secretary of State on that. They said, A, they weren't required, and B, if they were going to have voting machines put in, that they would help us. They're not going to standardize the state yet, but that was one of the, that's $100,000 cost savings to this county. Debbie.
My Fair Play staff can come to Bailey any day of the week and work, all six of them. The two staff in Bailey can come to Fair Play and work. Jody and Barb all started out in recording. They now do motor vehicle, they do election, they issue marriage licenses. I did not ask for $100,000 for election equipment. We don't know where the state is going with election equipment. Secretary Gessler, who is now running for governor, 2 years ago looking at a uniform election system for Colorado. We don't know where that is. We haven't had that discussion this year on what's going to happen with our new Secretary of State. We just know the equipment we have, it's time to replace it. It will be up to the county to fund election equipment. The election equipment we have now was funded by HAVA, Help America Vote App grant funding. That money is gone, so now the county will have to fund the election equipment. That is on the budget, with the budget and finance director has set up a line item. But with being on mail ballot, we need less equipment than what we needed 8 years ago when we purchased the equipment we have now. So I run my office very fluently. I've come under budget. You can talk to any commission that I've worked under. Every year, thousands of dollars under budget.
Tim. We've already done that.
Also?
I think so.
Tim, you've got 5 minutes.
Okay. Actually, it was the February Republican Party when you mentioned you were going to ask the commissioners the extra $100,000. What I want everybody in here to know is that we need some changes to happen here. I believe I can do this. I'm not going to sit in here after 12 years and say, you know, there's so much I haven't got done that I need this extra term to do it. I intend to get in there and do something in 4 years and make the changes that I want to see happen and not let it drag out and drag out and drag out. Also, I want everybody to know in here that this June, this election in June, is the important election. Like you said earlier, there are no Democrats running against any of us except for Commissioner. That Democrat is already in for the November election. The 4 out of 7 spots that you get to vote for in June are very important because after June, you don't have a choice. Your choice is now. And the people around you, their choices are now. If you're an independent here tonight, there are forms that you can get. You can fill out these forms, take them to the deputy or the clerk's office, and you can vote on June 24th. You can take that form in there that day. They should have them at the voting machines, which there will be one here in Bailey, and there will be one in Fairplay. The other towns aren't fortunate enough to have this voting machine because, guess what, we're mail-in ballots. And we don't have enough time or money, evidently, to do that. So get everybody out, make sure that they know this June election is the most important election that we have in this county this year, and tell them to vote. I'm Tim Armstrong. You've got my name out here on the signs. When you get to the voting ballot, you're going to see all of the incumbents, their names will be first on the list. It's like taking a test, A, B, C, D. You check A to start with, or you want to look at the names. All the new guys that are trying to break into this are the second name. So think about it. There's time for a change. I think I can make this office a better office. I want to get in, get out, and that's all I've got to say about it.
Hi, we are fourth generation to Park County. My father-in-law came here in 54, my husband came with him, Hartzell area. My husband's a graduate of Fairplay High School. Our sons, our twin granddaughters are now at Fairplay High School. This is home. We've been here over 40 some years. I'm like Fred, I'm not going anywhere. My son built my home. I'm here to stay, and when I went into the office 18 years ago today, my hope was this would be my last job. I put my heart and soul in it. It's not a job you learn. It's not easy. There is no room for error in the clerk's office and all that we do there. And I'm proud of the job that I have done. There's still more to do. Technology. And when the assessor's office hears Dave and Angie were talking about iCounting, that's a software my reporting software vendor developed, and we put it in our recording system to share with the assessor's office, to share over in the treasurer's office, to share down in the mapping department. And it's a website you can go on and log into. It's $25 for 24-hour access to look at our recording documents. Recording is my pride and joy. It's history of Park County. I have taken all our microfiche and aperture cards and had them digitized. All our books have been digitized. We're doing the cleanup. It's important to me that we save and preserve our documents. Our documents go back to the 1800s, and I'm proud of that. And it's been very important to me. There's other things coming down the pipeline for motor vehicle in recording, and I want to be a part of that so that when I walk away in 4 years, that there will be somebody that has the interest, the integrity that I've had over the last 12 years as your county clerk, that person will take my footsteps like I did Bart Pasco to go with this job. And I hope you will continue to support me and elect me in November so I can continue to do my job and work for you. Thank you.
They're doing a lot longer. Where'd Mark go?
Right.
He left. Well, anyway, I'm testing you.
Sorry. I'm going to go get this. It's all beat up, and I love it.
That was almost easy.
I'm back.
We promise not to fight, right?
No fight.
Alright.
No, because I'm in between the two of the
day. Tails. You get to choose who goes first.
Alright, I'll take it.
You want to go first?
Yeah, I'm thinking. Mark went first last time.
Okay, so you'll go first this time. What are some of the expenditures that are required of the county by state and federal regulation or statute?
I see quite a few. That's a good question for me because I'm not in office yet. People that are in office would know this a lot better than I do. I could go into it, I could stumble through it, but I'm not going to do that. I know when Mark and our other commissioners were elected as commissioner, they probably didn't know a lot of these questions and what expenditures were needed by each county from our commissioners. So I'll leave it at that, and I might spend a lot of time on it.
Most of our budget is already spent, and most of what we do is predetermined. We have a small amount, our PILT funds are about all we have that are discretionary funds. So most of our budget's already spent. You know, we have a responsibility for the roads. We have a responsibility for the health department, for human services. The human services and the road and bridge are mostly paid for by the state. We get highway user tax funds, or the expenditures that we have for our roads. The human services budget is 85% paid for by the state, and we pay 15%. People think if you get elected commissioner that you're like king of the world or something, and you're not. You've got legislators and governors above you that pretty much tell you this is where your money gets spent and this is what you have to do. So we have responsibilities, and we have to follow those responsibilities and obviously do that.
That's basically what I said. Mark would know more, Mike would know more, Dick would know more than I do. When it comes to these budgets and how much and where exactly they need to be spent, our county offices, as Mark mentioned, we have set budgets for those. To increase that, we have to fight for it, correct? So that's set upon us by the state, and we got to go with those guidelines and regulations, and leave it at that.
Okay, next question.
You go first.
Okay.
What is your view on personal property rights?
I was on the land use, regulations. We worked on those for 6 years when I was on the planning commission. And private property rights are among the most important rights that anybody can have. You know, it's what you do on your property. If you're not hurting other people, if you're not causing, I would say if you're shooting across your off your back porch and you're shooting at an old stump over there, and you've been shooting at it for years, and then somebody builds a house there, you can't shoot at that stump anymore. Have they taken something away from you? No, that wasn't really your right in the first place. Property rights are, they're good to the edge of the property. And there's, you know, we have laws and that you have to follow, but mostly it's, are you disturbing other people and are you causing other people problems? And if you're not, in Park County generally, it's pretty good, you know. We have land use regulations, and they're important. And we're always back and forth on them. Those things have like loose leaf where you can take them out and put new ones in. So you can change the land use regulations as we go along and as times change and as things become more condensed, as people are closer and closer together. Things that work in say in Berlin but might not work in South Park, and things that work in South Park might not work in Berlin. But you have to try to realize as things become more and more dense and there's more and more people, you start to lose some of your freedoms. And it's because you can't just keep shooting across your neighbor's lawn after they build their house there. It's just as things become tighter and tighter, we have more responsibilities to others.
Actually, I think you can shoot across your neighbor's lawn as long as you buy the bullets and supply the weapons for it. And I've done that. Personal property rights, very important. I just got a letter Friday, so this one kind of hits home to me. I guess one of my neighbors is bitching about my stuff. It's my property. I live on a private ranch. Park County does not maintain my roads. I have no public service there other than emergency service. I maintain my own road. Park County have the code enforcement get to tell me what I can do with my 35 acres? I don't think so. Can they tell them what you need to do with your property? I don't think so. But I do agree with Mark on one thing. If it causes people any kind of endangerment and or piles up of trash, which could be a fire hazard, which is also an endangerment, yes. I think somebody like Park County or code enforcement then does need to step in. And at first, ask. Take care of it. If that doesn't work in 30 to 60 days, then we need to get a little bit more stricter on it. But for the most part, it's my property, leave me alone. That's how I feel about it.
Our land use regs are complaint-based. So if you're not bothering your neighbors, generally they won't complain. So when your neighbors start complaining about stuff you're doing, you're bothering your neighbor. There's people that just continually pile trash on their property or throw bags of human waste on their neighbor's roof. And once you get to that, it's not private. You know, I mean, we've had this stuff come up. This is real. It isn't stuff I made up. So there comes a point where your behavior isn't publicly accepted anymore. And then people want to talk to the county about it, and then we try to bring people into some sort of compliance.
That would be bad. Definitely have to do something about that.
Sorry to bring that up, but it just came to mind.
what I was talking about there personally is a fellow property owner out on the ranch. He lives in the city. He doesn't even live up here. And he has a few problems with some neighbors around there, me being one of them. Because I have a lot of vehicles registered and insured, he doesn't like it. Well, that's his problem. He should live someplace else. Private property, respect it. That's how I feel that it ought to be.
Thank you. Okay, Taz. You go first.
Oh, boy.
How would you help to increase business opportunities in Park County?
I've been talking to folks about this for quite a while. Business opportunities, it's hard up here. In Park County, it's pretty difficult. To increase business opportunities, I think we gotta focus on the businesses we have here first. In order to do that, like I mentioned last week, in-your-face advertising, a little bit more support from the county, and that's not saying anything bad about the county. People need to realize they can go to their county offices if they need information about land use, about property taxes. They need to have this information out there, where to go, who to talk to, so they can get these things done. If you want to open a new business and you build a building, I think our county, our commissioners, our assessor's office, our clerk's office, we need to put some kind of packet together to help these folks out, to show them the way to do that. Because starting up as a new business owner, I did that 12 years ago. Fortunately, I'm ran by the state as a tow company. They regulate me. But in the county and the county businesses, you know, even dealing with the state, it would be nice if you could have an information packet that you can go get that tells you where to go, who to talk to, what it's going to cost, all that kind of thing. I think it'd make a huge difference on our businesses.
We have, one of the things we did was, we created this personal property tax rebate that if you expand or start a new business in Park County, you don't have to pay your personal property taxes for 5 years. And a new business when they're starting, they're so stressed out and just trying to make it. So we feel like there's an incubation period that you could help them with. But that, we looked, and that was the only thing legally that we could do tax-wise. We couldn't, like in the towns, we have something called ESTA, which is a tax rebate for the towns that they give their town tax back to them. But the county can't do that. We opened our new shooting range. We're trying to get tourism. We're trying to pull our the tourism part forward to try to increase businesses. But Gary Nichols showed me a survey that we did in 2000, and it talked about how do Park Countyans want their money spent. And the top thing, guess. Anybody here have a guess?
Roads.
Okay, that's the top thing. Now, we have put a bunch of money into roads, and we've worked hard to get roads. We're working hard to get roads, and they fall apart when you build them, and you just keep fixing them and fixing them and fixing them. It's a relentless process. And that helps with business. I work all the time to try to get more money for the state highways, for widening the highways, to get people to come up here. The nicer driving helps them. Nicer roads helps people come up here and not tear their cars up. Business is important to me, and people need to realize if you want more money for the roads, the very bottom thing was tourism development. But you have to have a few more tourists, and there's a sign that says, "Love thy gaper," and that's a Breckenridge sign, and the gapers are the people that come up and look at all the pretty stuff. Oh, right.
Tourism, I think we have it. Have any of you ever been on 285 in the weekends in the summer? How about next weekend? Stop and go. Takes you 6 to 7 hours to go from Fairplay to Denver on a Sunday. We have the traffic. Now how are we going to make them stop and spend the money? We have beautiful fishing. We have beautiful hunting. We got campgrounds that if you haven't been there, your buddy hasn't been there, you don't know about it. So they don't even know to stop. They go down and see the signs. It's on right on the side of the highway. Big in-your-face advertising. Down in Buena Vista, KOA camping, all the rafting, everything that they have down there. They have it, we might not. But there is a lot of things that we do have. Drive right through South Park. How many campgrounds do you pass? I bet you none of you can tell me, because you don't know they're there. Well, we have them. How come we aren't advertising them? And we're not making the people stop there. They just sit in traffic until they get to Chaffee County. That's one thing we need to do. We have the traffic. Now let's make them stop. We need Want more money for the roads? How about
this is a rebuttal.
Oh, crap. Sorry.
Room tax. Every time you go somewhere and stay in a hotel, you're paying a room tax, bedroom tax. We don't have that in Park County. We don't have to pay it. We live here. If you want to stay in a hotel, then I think you ought to pay that. We pay it everywhere else. Why don't people pay it here?
Minute now.
Okay. The signs, the state doesn't let you put off-site signs up. The state highways won't let you put more signs up. They're not into that. We've gone back and forth with them about the towns, about Como and Guffey, trying to get signs for Como and Guffey. Other than the sign, little sign that says Como, or maybe you can rent those blue signs, and they're very spendy, but the state doesn't like other signs, so you either rent their signs or you don't get signs. If it's on the property, it's not going to be the county that's going to put the signs up, it's going to be the business. So that's not really our job. Part of being a commissioner is knowing what is doable and what's not doable. And the first few years you're in there, you're going, wow, let's do this, wow, let's do that. And, you can't do that. No, you can't do that either. And even being a mayor, there was a lot of things that I had as a mayor that you just can't do in the county. The rules are different. So a lot of it's not the common sense stuff. It's there's laws and state laws and we are an arm of the state. We're a statutory county, so we follow the rules and constitution of the state. So that's just kind of the way it is.
Mark just got done, so. I know there's rules that we have to follow, and I think we could do a lot more fighting about that. When Mark brought up, we had state only allows you so much for advertising and signs. My question would be then, if that's true, then how come all the other counties have it? How come they're growing? How come they have advertisement, in-your-face advertisement, and we don't? I would want to find out. Maybe they'll try to shut me down, but I'm the type of person that likes to fight, and I'll fight for the people. Business right down here on Crow Hill, 200 square foot sign. They wanted to put two of them up, northbound and southbound. Talked to them. Park County told him he couldn't, the only one. At his expense, he was gonna pay it. He was gonna buy it, build it, put it up. Park County told him he couldn't. I'd like to know why. I'd like to get to the bottom of that. Not being in office, of course I wouldn't know everything, but I'll find out. And means this is my 5 minutes. I'll tell you folks a little bit about myself. Started working when I was 8 years old, paying taxes when I was 8 years old. Professional mechanic for 16 years. Me and my wife April bought Silver Hills Towing 12 years ago. In 12 years, we turned it into almost $500,000 company. Last year, we did just under $300,000. And you're supposed to sell it for double whatever your last gross income was. So puts us about right there. Pretty proud of that. 2011, Silver Hills Towing was AAA Provider of the Year. Most of all of you know AAA name. It's a big company. It was an honor and a privilege to receive that for a little company in Park County. Very, very hard to do. We did it. Why am I running for County Commissioner? It's not that Mark has done a bad job. I think he's a great guy. I think I've heard a couple other people say this, it's time for some new blood. I'm willing to get beat up and yell that a little bit. I'm sure I will. And take your suggestions and comments and take them to heart and see what I can do with it. I'm willing to work for the people. That's what I've been doing in this county for the last 12, 13 years. I'm going to continue to do that in any capacity, whether it's with the tow company or as your commissioner or both. I love this county. I've been on just about every road in this county at one time or another, usually in the middle of the night when the sheriff's department calls me. But I go out and I do my job. I don't ever bitch about it. I just get it done. We do a lot of pro bono in this county, taking care of folks. I could probably have brand new trucks, but I don't because of things like that that I do, and I choose to do that. I'm proud to serve the people. We do scholarship at South Park High School. Do that for a female student every year for the last, I believe this will be our fourth year. Just a little bit to give back. And the reason we do that is because this is our home, these are our people, this is our county. And I appreciate it, all the opportunities you guys have gave me. And if you vote for me, I'll continue to fight for you, continue to listen to you, and try to see if we can't get something to change and something done in this county. Thank you.
Mark.
19, almost 20 years ago, I've been here like 25 years, and the first few years I've been skiing a lot, playing. As time went on, I realized I wanted to give something back to my community. And I went down to the fire station in Alma, the little station, and told them I wanted to volunteer. And those guys scared me half to death. And I sat there that night after talking to them. They were talking about fire flying over your head and pieces of bodies down the highway and all the, like it was a really exciting thing. And I laid in bed that night and I couldn't sleep at all. And thank you to all of you that do that. Thank you to the first responders here. I'm not a first responder. Thanks, Taz, for going and picking up the people in the tow truck. So they don't spend the night on the highway. I appreciate that too. But that I couldn't do that, and I realized at that night that it wasn't for me. So it wasn't too long, much longer, I went down and there was an opening on the town board, and I got on the Alma town board. I spent two terms, 8 years on the Alma town board. Then I did a term and a half as mayor before when Doc McKay passed away, and I ran for Park County commissioner. I spent in the meantime while I was mayor, I spent 6 years on the planning commission. So I volunteered for 15 years to earn this job. I didn't know that's why I was doing it, but that's the way it turned out. So I knew a lot about CDOT. I knew how to deal with CDOT because of the town of Alma. I knew a lot about the dealing with the state. I knew a lot of the things. And then from my Park County Planning Commission years, I learned, and Board of Adjustments, I learned a lot of the land use and the regulations that come with it. So I spent a long time getting ready for this. And then I've done 6 years as county commissioner, and I'd like to do my last 4 years, and I'm not going to run again for anything. I'm with Fred. This is it for me. We've talked a lot tonight about training and years of experience and how that helps. And I really feel that you don't want to spend 4 more years training somebody while you have somebody that's trained. And I am ready to go, and I love this job. I love Park County. My years here, I won't go anywhere either. I have a business in Alma of rental properties, and if I don't do this, I'll do that. I'll do it anyway. So, you know, I love this county. My first time I remember coming through here, I was a little boy, and my parents lived in Albuquerque, and my aunt and uncle lived in Denver, and we came driving up 285, and we did it all the time, and I remember somewhere along the way saying, someday I'd like to live here, to my mom, and she said, oh, you can't live in the mountains, there's no way to live there, you can't afford it. But when I was in my early 30s, I got an opportunity, and we came out here, and we bought a little cabin, and I never went back to Missouri. It was 3 years before we ever went back to our house, because we loved it here so much. And I don't want to go anywhere, I don't like going on vacation, anywhere else I go, I'm disappointed. I love it here. My everyday life is so much better than any vacation that I don't want to go anywhere else. I'm happy here. I love serving you. When you people call me and want something fixed, want something worked on, I do my very best to help with whatever it is that you want taken care of if I can do it. And I'll continue to do that. Thank you for the years that I've spent doing this. It's been an honor and an incredible education. It's been a great ride. I love Park County, and I want to serve as long as I can. And one more term is all I'm allowed by term limits, and I'd like to do that for you.
Okay, thank you guys. That's it for the evening.
It's always talking
to you. Please hang around and chat with them. We've got cookies and coffee and I think a lot of stuff to eat back there, so talk to your candidates. Thank you very much for coming.